Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Perpetual Astonishment of Jonathon Fairfax by Christopher Shevlin, narrated by Finlay Robertson. Sunday. Chapter 1. Being murdered is a surprisingly effective way of losing weight. The thought would never have occurred to Sarah Morecambe if she had not recently been stabbed to death in her own kitchen. Blood, for example, is remarkably heavy. A good, deep stab wound can take half a stone off you in a couple of minutes. And then there's the famous 21 grams that the soul weighs. It's not much, but every little helps. Sarah was trying hard to look on the bright side, to find what her mother called the rainbow in the storm. But nothing, not even dramatic weight loss, makes up for being killed over a late afternoon cup of tea in your own newly decorated kitchen. To make it worse, she had left the cat's Sunday fish frying on top of the cooker. There was almost no chance that the murderer would think to turn off the hob, and then her house would burn down before she had even finished decorating it. And how would anyone be able to solve her murder then? Some of her hair was trailing in the cat's bowl, and the body was lying in an awkward position with its left arm behind its back and its right leg bent double. She saw now that the leggings had been a mistake, but the knitted silk top was good. Burgundy suited her, though it didn't go at all well with the bright red blood that was pooling out all around her, spreading so fast that the murderer was having to take little steps back to avoid staining his white trainers. She realized, as she watched him bend to leave the knife on her stomach, that the murderer's balaclava was exactly the same color as her top. He muttered, "Sorry, love," as though he had just accidentally pulled out in front of her at a junction, rather than deliberately stabbed her to death. Then he backed out of the kitchen. She didn't hear his footsteps in the hall. Neither did she hear the front door close. Had he gone? And how could she hear anything when her ears were lying dead on her beautiful new slate floor? There was no doubt that she could hear. The click of the cat flap was, if anything, sharper and louder than usual as Purdy nosed it open from the outside. Sarah now bitterly regretted having saddled the cat with a joke name. She had meant it to be a joke on joke cat names, but now there would be no one around to explain those two incriminating R's on Purdy's bowl. There would also, she suddenly realized, be no one around to fill the bowl. Purdy saw Sarah's body and froze. Both ears swiveled to their alarm position. After a long time, Purdy blinked, then padded very slowly closer to the body. The cat sniffed at the blood, gave it a tiny lick, and then sat down and let out a thin meow. Sarah had always hoped that Purdy loved her, but it's difficult to tell with cats. The real test of their loyalty and affection is whether, left alone with your dead body, they refuse to eat you. Chapter 2. Earlier that same Sunday. Jonathon Fairfax was astonished. This was nothing new. His first memory of being astonished dated from the age of 3, when his mother had quite casually suggested that, instead of wearing a pair of comfy, watertight pants, he should spend the rest of his life holding in his wee and poo. Now, 17 years later, he was astonished because a huge, terrifying man in a smart, dark red balaclava was asking him directions. "Sorry," said Jonathon, putting down his laundry bag and taking a firmer hold on his box of washing powder. The street, a canyon of old red brick terraces, was deserted. It was wide but thickly lined with cars. Nearby, a cluster of houses had been infected by that feared North London disease that turns any unwary building into a chicken shop. The day was cold, and the March sky overhead was a perfectly neutral grey, the sort of sky that can happily sit above any kind of weather.
"I said, do you know where Acacia Road is?"
The man spoke slowly, and emphasized the words by shrugging his shoulders into his suede bomber jacket. They were large shoulders, as though when it came to building the man's upper body, God had decided simply to use a whole cow. "Acacia Road?" asked Jonathon, goggling.
"Yes," said the man.
He really was enormous. Some might have said that he had no neck, but this was an illusion caused by the fact that he had so much neck. It started at the edges of his huge shoulders and tapered only slightly to meet his muscular head. Did the man somehow do a head workout? Jonathon wondered. Though it was dwarfed by his neck and covered by his balaclava, the man's beefy head looked as though it could bench press 200 pounds on its own.
We're on. This is Acacia Road, said Jonathon.
He stood on one leg, a gesture he had done for comic effect as a child, but which had now become instinctive when he was in awkward situations.
Is it? Don't say so. Where's the signs?
The man stared hard at Jonathon, as though he suspected him of having stolen all the signs. Jonathon was easily intimidated. In fact, left alone for long enough, Jonathon could probably have contrived to intimidate himself, but now that he was being stared at aggressively by a giant in a balaclava, he was more astonished and confused than afraid. The man seemed to be waiting for an answer. Had he asked a question? Jonathon couldn't remember.
Sorry, he said.
The man sighed impatiently and pinched the bridge of his nose. He stopped, then put his hand to his cheek as though to confirm what his fingers had told him, which was, presumably, that he was wearing a balaclava. This seemed to surprise him.
I get a cold face, said the man.
Yes, said Jonathon, stupidly.
Right, said the man.
He slapped his big cauldron of a belly, shouldered his way across the empty road, pulled himself into an old grey Jaguar, and drove off. Jonathon stood for some seconds in the grey empty street, paralysed by astonishment, before carrying on down the road and into the laundrette. Jonathon stuffed his washing into the machine and sat down. Like much in London's Holloway Road area, the laundrette had apparently been transported directly from Soviet Russia. It was a large, pocked, windowless cell full of fluorescent light, 1960s washing machines, and instructions fixed in place with yellowing sellotape. Looking in his laundry bag, Jonathon remembered that he had, the previous Sunday, inadvertently laundered the book he was reading. He looked around for distractions, but the other people in the laundrette were silently watching their clothes rotate, intent on avoiding eye contact. He got up and collected a selection of the leaflets and flyers that lay on the windowsill, some so old that the writing on them had faded almost to invisibility. Jonathon sat back down. "Missing cat," announced the first leaflet, displaying a photo of a cat with one ear. He realized that he couldn't possibly face looking at the next leaflet, and so settled back, like the others, to watch his clothes go round and round. Jonathon was in London, waiting for his life to begin, waiting to be recognised, though he had no idea for what. Balladeer? Advocate? Swordsman? He should start learning to do something. More urgently, he needed friends. He felt that if he didn't make friends soon, he would die. Actually, it was unlikely he would die. Instead, he would have to take the more effortful and dispiriting alternative of going to live in Humberside, the latest stop in his dad's quest for perfect bleakness.
"You're going to London,"
his dad had said, in much the same incredulous tone he would have used if Jonathon had announced that he planned to have his head laminated.
"Is there any more marmalade?"
Jonathon had replied.
"London chews people up and spits them out like pancakes."
"Like pancakes?"
Jonathon asked. "Yes, I think there's some left. Why?"
"Are we talking about marmalade or pancakes?"
"We're talking about life. London is a mistake, the most unfriendly city on earth."
Now, the point at which Jonathon would have to concede that it was impossible to make friends in London was fast approaching. How, he wondered, did anyone in London come to know anyone else? There seemed to be no situations at all in which it was remotely permissible to talk to people you don't know. Public transport, laundrettes, pubs, cafes, swimming pools, shops, pavements, libraries, all were strictly off limits. You could ask directions and buy things. Nothing else was allowed. Even at work, he had no friends. He had stupidly chosen to get a job at Harrods because it was famous, but the rigid and inflexible caste system that operated among its employees meant that he would have to be there for at least another 10 years before anyone might, for example, ask him if he'd had a nice weekend. By then, the prospect of ever actually having a nice weekend would have irretrievably vanished. As a result, although he had been in London for only 3 months, he was already living too much in his own head. He had constructed an extraordinarily detailed fantasy life, in which he divided his time between his studio in Paris and his apartment in Constantinople, visiting London tanned and full of mystery, hailed as Europe's foremost poet and stockbroker, or something. His clothes were elegant and simple, hand-tailored by the finest hands. His shirts made beautiful women weep. The fantasy bore no relation to any element of his current or past life. He lived in a tiny room in a gigantic house shared by strangers, and the clothes that the washing machine was currently hurling around inside itself were boring, threadbare jeans and jumpers. How, he wondered, had he acquired such childish, sensible and unsexy clothes? They were perfect for a camping trip in 1950s Norway, but utterly unsuited to the roiling fleshpot of London in the mid-1990s. Eventually, over the course of the cycle, he forgave his clothes. When they were clean and only slightly damp, he put them in his laundry bag and made his way over to the door, where he was escorted from the premises by the implacable stare of the flint-eyed attendant who sat in an orange plastic chair. The bell beside the door gonged his exit. No sooner had Jonathon set foot on the street than he saw the huge, terrifying man, this time without his balaclava, pull up in his old Jaguar. Jonathon thought briefly of turning around and going back into the laundrette, but the awkwardness of doing so scared him even more than the huge, terrifying man did. He would pretend not to see the man. He squinted his eyes as though blinded by the dim grey sun and walked on. Chapter 3. The murderer was furious and deeply frustrated. For 15 minutes he had been hunting with no sign of his prey. Then, just as he was on the verge of giving up, he spotted it. "The parking space hasn't been born that can outsmart me," he thought. It had done its best, sandwiching itself between a rotting yellow Volvo and a dirty white Bedford van, but he had sniffed it out, and now he was going to fill it. He glanced in his mirror, stopped, put his arm around the passenger seat, and reversed into the gap with a single liquid move. Satisfaction surged up from his belly, and he put the first smile of the afternoon on his face. He had never tried heroin, but he doubted that it beat a really good bit of reverse parking. Having to go away and come back had cost him a lot of time, but it's stupid to go and kill someone when you've just been seen in the victim's street wearing a balaclava. You have to leave time for the memories to fade. The murderer had taken a spin up to Highgate, had a half, watched a bit of a match and come back. Not unpleasant, but still a waste of time. It was all that kid's fault. Some people can take a balaclava in their stride, but that kid had stared at him like he was astonished or something. The army, thought the murderer, isn't the answer to everything, but it would knock the astonishment out of a kid like that in a second. Selective conscription, that's what they needed. He checked his face again. No balaclava. Good. The balaclava was a present from his niece. It was fantastic, cashmere, and extremely comfortable. The problem was that it was so comfortable, he couldn't tell whether or not he was wearing it. That was a big problem, because people tend to look askance at other people wearing balaclavas. This was, he felt, a national disgrace. Men wearing balaclavas had fought and died for Britain. Anyway, this time he would make sure that he didn't put it on until the last minute. He patted his inside pocket to make sure the kitchen knife was there. Then he unlocked the glove compartment, opened the box, and took out a fresh pair of surgical gloves. He could put those on now. Just as he was about to open the car door, he looked up. Not again, he groaned to himself. There, coming out of a laundrette, was the kid he'd asked for directions. The kid was squinting, carrying a laundry bag over his shoulder and a box of Persil under his arm, spilling a fine line of powder behind him. Had the kid seen him? Chapter 4. A huge, terrifying man wearing a balaclava asks you for directions. You tell him that the street he's looking for is the one he's currently in. He gets in his car and drives off. Later, you see him again in the same street, this time without his balaclava, just about to get out of his car. He sees you and drives off again. This would be a confusing sequence of events for anyone. For Jonathon, who hovered perpetually on the brink of confusion, it only confirmed his decision to have a nerve-steadying coffee. He gripped his box of washing powder more firmly, settled his laundry bag more comfortably over his shoulder, and walked on, making for the Brown Cafe, a few streets away. The Brown Cafe was not its real name, but since Jonathon knew no one, and particularly no one who knew the Brown Cafe, it made no difference what he called it in the privacy of his own head. The outside of the cafe was the colour of toffee, the windows sepia-tinted, and today smeared with a sticky-looking substance. Its fawn sign glinted in the late afternoon sun, and upon it, written in large beige letters, were the words, Café Acropolis. Inside, there was nothing relating to the Acropolis, to Greece, or even to Southern Europe. Everything, however, was brown. Many things were also sticky. Jonathon took his place at one of a pair of umber tables in an alcove. On either side of the alcove were waist-high structures made of hazel brick, containing leafy synthetic plants that had faded to a dull khaki. In the main part of the cafe, two rusty metal columns held the roof up, or the floor down. The ceiling was painted the colour of nicotine, and the walls gradually faded from caramel to buff as they approached the sticky sienna floor. Jonathon put down his laundry bag and his washing powder, settled his leaflets in front of him, and then went to the counter where there was a weathered woman, apparently made of mahogany. She scowled, but permitted him to order a coffee. You wait, she told him. Sit down. She motioned him away with a flick of her hand. Taking his seat again, Jonathon looked around. From his table, he could see the whole of the cafe, including the door. He was afraid that at any moment the bell next to it would tinkle, and in would walk the terrifying man in the balaclava, or, as the case might be, not in the balaclava. To take his mind off the prospect of seeing the terrifying man again, Jonathon carefully prized one of the leaflets from the sticky tabletop and pretended to study it carefully. It was the one about the missing one-eared cat. He couldn't focus on it. He raised his eyes and looked at the other customers. Two tables away, an elderly couple sat side by side, wearing matching quilted coats, and watching their table as intently as if it were showing repeats of the Dukes of Hazzard. Near them, but not too near, sat a small man wearing an old tan suit. Jonathon thought that the cafe probably gave the man an ease he didn't feel elsewhere. He was eating a plate of chips, half covered with a glutinous brown mass, which could well have been a pie. The man looked up. Jonathon reflexively smiled, and the man looked away. He was the only man Jonathon had ever seen who was halfway through growing a comb-over.
This intrigued and astonished Jonathon, sending his mind spinning into new avenues of distracted speculation. The strands of hair, teased over from the right-hand side of his head, stopped in an abrupt ridge just before the apex of his cranium, leaving the left-hand side of his shiny scalp entirely exposed. Jonathon had always assumed that the comb-over happened gradually, as the hair slowly fled. But this man was deliberately growing a brand new comb-over on an already bald head. What was the explanation? Had he woken up one morning to find that all the hair had fallen out of the top of his head? Was he a former monk who, on leaving the order, had found that his tonsure was now permanent? Jonathon did not know. He couldn't stop thinking about it. After the agonizing decision to grow a comb-over, there must have been the question of what to do with the flap of hair as it grew. Should he allow it to fall naturally over one ear? Tie it in a small bunch? Tuck it away coquettishly? This man had decided to paste it over his head as far as it would go. The decision was reasonable. Seen from the right, he already looked like a man with an almost full comb-over. A coffee cup crashed down in front of Jonathon, making him jump. He realized that once again he had been living in his own head, imagining the half-bald man's plight rather than, for example, working out how to sort out his own life. At that moment, the bell beside the door tinkled. Jonathon looked up. The man who walked in was not the terrifying one who had asked him for directions, but someone who looked almost equally out of place in the brown cafe. He was tall and annoyingly dashing, in his late 20s, and wearing a jacket that fit perfectly in a way that normal people's clothes just don't. His shirt, Jonathon suspected, might well have already made a beautiful woman weep that day, possibly more than one woman, possibly more than once. He's probably called something cool like Lance or Ivan, thought Jonathon resentfully. The man was followed by a striking and dignified lady in her late 50s. Jonathon didn't usually use the word lady, even in his thoughts, but there was really no other word for the lady who had walked in after the dashing man. She wore a kindly but imperious air and an expensive trouser suit, and there was something about her that suggested that she might once have been famous, possibly for being Lauren Bacall, if Lauren Bacall had been English, and in colour. They strode magnificently over and sat at the table next to Jonathon's in the leafy alcove, where the light was a little less overpoweringly brown, and there was some protection from the stickiness of the kitchen at the back. Jonathon immediately took up his leaflets again and began to study them furiously. So, he thought, a cat has gone missing. There's a missing cat. A cat is missing. Cat.
Whoa, said Lance. Hold it right there.
Jonathon sneaked a look at them. Lance had put out a hand as though to shield Lauren Bacall from some horror. With the other hand, he pointed to something on the menu.
I dare you, he said, to have the seafood platter.
Lauren Bacall looked at the menu and giggled. All her imperiousness dropped away, and she seemed like a little girl. Jonathon realized that he had been staring at them, so he quickly occupied himself in removing the sticky film from the surface of his coffee. It struck him that the sight of him spooning the skin from his coffee and draping it on the table might offend them just as much as being stared at, but he had to continue. After all, how could he drink it when it had more skin than he did?
Then I shall have the seafood platter, said Lauren Bacall, but only if you have the meat soup, ducky lamb. And if it's edible, I'm sending it straight back. I already suspect that this isn't the worst cafe in London.
It is, I swear.
Let's ask this young man what he thinks. He looks discerning. If he says it's nice, we're leaving immediately.
Jonathon tensed. He was going to have to talk to people.
You wear the trousers, lady.
Lauren Bacall turned to Jonathon.
Excuse me, she said. What's the coffee like here?
He would not, he decided, become confused. He would certainly not run away.
Hadn't he already survived both the laundrette and the man with the balaclava and the muscular face? What was it like? Just say anything that comes into your head. It doesn't matter. Brown, he said. He thought again and added, and quite sticky. He cocked his head on one side in another of those once comic gestures. Was that weird? He wondered. But Lance and Lauren Bacall seemed perfectly happy with his answer. They looked at each other and exchanged a nod. And the food? Lance added. I didn't dare try the food. Lauren Bacall turned to Lance. We shall stay. Lance looked around. Do they have waitresses here? He asked. Sort of, but I don't think they take orders. I think you might have to go to the desk over there, answered Jonathon, pointing. Good sign, said Lance. He unfolded himself from his seat and made his way over to the counter. Do you come here often? Asked Lauren Bacall. She was very English, and also very much not black and white. She definitely wasn't Lauren Bacall. This is my second, no, third, fourth time. Is this your first? Yes. We take it in turns to take each other out to lunch every couple of weeks. He takes me to the worst places you can possibly find, and I show him the nicest ones. It's a very amicable arrangement. Jonathon laughed, and this made the lady who wasn't Lauren Bacall smile. So, Ducky, she asked, are you here because you like horrible cafes? No, he said, and considered. He couldn't tell her that he was here because he had seen a man in a balaclava, and then the same man not in a balaclava, or that he couldn't stand the idea of sitting in his little bedsit anymore. He couldn't tell her that he had decided to come here rather than going to the area's nicer cafe because he was afraid the staff in the nicer cafe might ask him why he spent so much time alone in cafes. In fact, there wasn't anything he could tell her that would put him in a good light. I'm here through religious conviction, he heard himself say. At that moment, Lance returned and draped himself over the chair again, exhaling slowly upwards through his mouth, blowing his long fringe about. You sit in terrible cafes as a form of worship? He asked, smiling and apparently intrigued. Jonathon nodded sagely. Still, you'd have to be pretty devout to come to this one, said Lance. I'm an archbishop. And so the conversation began. Jonathon was drawn into the talk of these two pleasantly odd people as they improvised the details of his cafe religion and the hierarchy of its priestly order. They seemed to feel that discussing actual things was beneath them. Their conversation was an odd, semi-surreal mixture of deliberate banalities, light ironies, and playful banter. Jonathon felt at home with this. In a world that obstinately refused to make any sense at all, Jonathon had always felt it was presumptuous to talk as though it did. This belief was confirmed when they introduced themselves. The dashing man really was called Lance. Lance Furman. His name, like James Bond's, lent itself to being delivered in two installments. Disappointingly, Lauren Bacall's name turned out to be Jane Archer Hollis, and Jonathon decided that she probably hadn't once been famous after all. So what's your name? Asked Lance, after they invited him to their table. Jonathon Fairfax. Oh, any relation? Jane looked at Lance quizzically. There's an author called Richard Fairfax, writes airport novels, Lance explained. He's my dad, said Jonathon. Sorry. No. He's really your dad. Mm-hmm, Jonathon replied, nodding like Stan Laurel, another of those gestures. Lance laughed loudly, though whether at the gesture or the information was impossible to say. I read most of the Carousel Code when I flew over to Holland a couple of weeks ago. It's pretty good. Better than Orly Riser or Excess Baggage. The conversation was interrupted by Lance's mobile phone, the first Jonathon had ever seen at close quarters, making a distressed peeping noise. Everyone in the cafe looked over at him. Even the old couple tore their eyes away from the fascinating table. Sorry,
said Lance. I'll leave that.
The peeping continued. I've never seen anyone answer a mobile phone before, said Jonathon.
But I'm not answering it, said Lance.
Oh.
Okay, just to please you. Lance picked up the large black brick, pulled out its aerial, and pressed a button. Lance Furman, he said. Yes. Yes, I am. No, fine.
Really?
Jonathon wished Lance would repeat the question in his answer, as in Australian soaps and English exams. Cool. No, I'm glad you called me. Yes, I'll be right over. No problem, I... Yes, great. No, it'll probably take me a bit longer than that. No, I don't think so. He craned his neck, looking around. Oh, sorry. Someone at your door, right. Okay then, bye.
Jane looked at him sidelong. Was that a young lady? She asked.
Lance put the phone down, but carried on looking at it. No. He continued to stare at the phone for a couple of seconds and then shook his head as though breaking a reverie. All right. Granted, it was a young lady, but not a young lady. Not in the way you mean it. She's a civil servant. Her name's Sarah Morecambe.
Chapter 5. Just as the door was opening, the murderer remembered that he hadn't put his balaclava back on. Fudge, he thought. A slightly overweight woman opened the door, speaking into a cordless phone.
Of course, my tour. See you later. Bye.
She gave a slight jump when she saw the murderer.
Sorry, she said, smiling and pointing at the phone. Trying to do two things at once. I'm having one of those days. Now, what can I do for you?
The murderer wished that he had put his balaclava on. It would have made it much easier. Now she was being nice to him.
Can I come in? He asked.
His voice sounded to him serious and businesslike. That was the way to do this. She looked surprised, but opened the door and stepped back.
Yes, of course, she said.
Is this about the neighbourhood watch?
He moved into the hallway, the shoulders of his suede bomber jacket touching both sides of the doorframe. She bustled along in front of him, fidgeting with a bracelet. Her house, he noticed, was a right mess.
Cup of tea? She asked.
Go on in, he said.
She filled the kettle from a water purifier beside the sink. He looked around the room. Click. The cat flap half opened, and a black nose appeared, sniffed and then withdrew.
You must think I'm terrible, all this mess. I only moved in a bit ago.
There was a pause, a silence.
Ghost moved, did it?
The murderer asked, not really knowing why. She raised her eyebrows at him.
The move, he explained. Did a ghost move?
She laughed. I'm sorry. I'm miles away today. You must think I'm terrible. I'm not usually as bad as this. She laughed again, shaking her head.
Miles away, she repeated.
The move was absolutely bloody murder, I'm afraid to say it. The lorry, carrying all my worldly goods, got lost on the way here. Didn't arrive till the next day. What a cock-up. Thought I'd never get it back. And it's taken me ages to get the kitchen done. You'd think I'd learn after last time. Have you moved often?
Just once. A couple of years ago. Nightmare. Broke all our plates.
He was still looking around. The kitchen units were new, but the walls unpapered and the floor had traces of plaster on it. There were lots of little strip lights under the units to illuminate the work surfaces, but the main light in the centre of the ceiling had no tube in it. Behind him, the gas flame hissed under a pan of fish on the hob. The cooker controls glowed blue and were reflected in a half-drunk sherry. He met her eyes. She'd seen him looking at the sherry.
I know, she said. You must think I'm terrible hitting the bottle when it's... My God, it's not even 5.
She reached down 2 mugs from a cupboard.
I'm not really an alky, honest, my lord.
She laughed, and he smiled politely. His hand slipped into the pocket of his jacket.
Biscuits?
She asked.
What? No, cheers.
His leg was jigging compulsively up and down. The breakfast bar stool on which he sat was becoming desperately uncomfortable. Sarah was slowly taking the tea bag out of his mug. As she poured in the milk, she looked up and met his eyes.
Now, how can I help? She asked. Chapter 6.
I met her at that conference in Holland a couple of weeks ago, said Lance. She's a secretary, works at Defence, so I gave her my card and she just called to say she's got something she'd like to discuss with me, off the record.
I suppose you lied and told her you're a journalist, said Jane.
Yes, yeah, I did. I mean, no one would tell me anything if I said I was a spy.
Lance likes to think he's a spy.
Lance laughed, but he looked a little hurt. I work for a leading investigative solutions consultancy, he explained. I can't tell you its name. Careless talk costs lives.
Lance can't remember the name of the company he works for, said Jane. And he's more a loss adjuster than a spy. Don't ever listen to anything he says.
The waitress arrived with coffees for them all, and the conversation stopped while they extracted the skin. All three of them silently piled their skin in a single heap in the middle of the table, and this soon became a game. It's a sculpture.
But of what, Lance, my darling? Of what?
It's abstract, said Lance.
Oh, wait, said Jonathon.
He gave the pile of skin a couple of deft pats with his teaspoon.
It's Michael Winner's nose, he said.
Golly, said Jane.
I have to admit, said Lance, that really does look like Michael Winner's nose. Jonathon smiled, disproportionately pleased with his creation. So anyway, said Lance, Sarah works for Andrew Thompson. She's his secretary. Jane made a face to express her distaste. Jonathon also tried to show his disapproval. Lance laughed. Are you trying to do an impression of Princess Anne? He asked Jonathon.
I was trying to scowl.
Your scowl needs work. Your Princess Anne impression, however, is excellent.
Thompson really is a nasty piece of work, said Jane seriously. He's such a horrid little man.
He's my boss, said Lance.
Jonathon and Jane both looked at him.
Well, indirectly, Lance conceded.
What do you mean, indirectly? Asked Jonathon.
Jonathon, do you have any contacts in the world of politics, big business, or intelligence?
Jonathon had no contacts, not even electrical ones. He had nothing. Not contacts as such, no.
Then I'll tell you this, in confidence. Jonathon had noticed that when people feel safe and aren't being forced to compete, they often reveal the most intimate information. In fact, being almost the embodiment of non-threatening, Jonathon had found before moving to London that they often chose him to reveal it too. Previously, the people he had affected in this way had mostly been strangers on buses and often drunk. Now, for the first time in his life, he seemed he was about to be told something interesting.
I work for an investigative agency which is trying to break into the political scene. We've been doing surveillance work for news agencies and insurance firms for years, but anyway, we were taken on by Andrew Thompson to get some background info on one of his enemies, Graham Hutton.
He's the big pink one, isn't he? Asked Jane. Pensions or something?
Yes, that's him. Pink or purple, he can do either. So I was in Holland at some EU thing, posing as a journalist, but actually watching this guy, Thompson's enemy. He's got to be hiding something.
The best place to hide something, said Jonathon, is in the home of a man who thinks he is hiding something else.
That's deep, said Lance.
What are you talking about? Sorry, it was in a children's program I watched. Professor Albino's Circus Factory. Have you ever seen it?
Jonathon looked at them both, suddenly feeling that saying anything that came into his head wasn't such a good idea after all.
I haven't, said Jane, but Lance and I are a little bit older than you. When I was growing up, we didn't really have children's programs, or indeed television. Lance?
Drawing a blank. Sorry.
It's all right. Even people who are exactly the same age as me haven't seen it. No one has. I don't know why. Perhaps it was broadcast just for you, Ducky.
Maybe. I thought you might have seen it for some reason. It was good. Professor Albino would draw the curtains at the end after the adventure,
and give a piece of odd advice. The one about the best place to hide something is the only one I remember now. But anyway, sorry, you were watching Hutton at an EU thing. I'll shut up now.
Lance looked at him, frowning, as though checking that he really would shut up. Then he smiled and continued.
Yes, Holland. A lot of politicians really let their hair down at European stuff. The tabloids don't bother sending journalists over there. And the local papers don't care what British politicians do, so they're not on their guard.
Did you get anything? Asked Jonathon.
Not there, no.
I've got a little bit on him. Finished the file last week. I hope it's enough. If not, I'll be back to investigating insurance fraud faster than you can say knife.
Knife? Asked Jonathon. He'd never heard the expression before.
Much faster than that. You say knife slower than anyone I've ever met.
Sorry.
Hey, don't sweat it.
You were telling us about Sarah, darling, said Jane.
Yes. That's why I was talking about Holland. That's where I met Sarah, Thompson's secretary. We got talking and I think she was putting out feelers about leaking stuff to me.
How do you know?
Call it instinct. Anyway, I gave her my card and now she's called.
Jane said, but if you're working for Thompson, why would you want her to leak anything to you? Surely it would embarrass him.
Is it so that she wouldn't leak it to anyone else? Asked Jonathon.
Ah, clever, said Lance. No, it's more just idle curiosity, or professional curiosity, I forget which. Maybe we would tell Thompson, it depends. But I won't know unless I go and see her.
Perhaps this Sarah just wants to lure you to her house, suggested Jane.
Why do you think I carry this around? Said Lance, pretending to use his hefty phone as a club.
What I can't understand, said Jane, is everybody saying how attractive Thompson is. I mean, he's my husband's age. I just don't see it. I really don't.
He's got that twinkle in his eye that women just can't resist. And his own castle.
But he is a repellent man. He always wears that nasty little smirk on his face, as though...
But she couldn't think what it was, as though. Instead, she said,
I don't know, I really don't.
Have either of you heard of Nicholas Emir Brunsengett? Asked Jonathon.
They both shook their heads.
He has this, theory.
Gone, said Lance.
Well, he thinks that women like tall, strong, handsome men for evolutionary reasons. But he also has this research that says that, as well as the tall, strong, handsome thing, every woman also has a non-evolutionary predilection.
An NEP, said Lance.
You have read his book, said Jonathon.
No, just a wild guess. What's his book?
Men are from Mars. Women are also from Mars.
Ah, what's an NEP?
It's, an attraction for a certain type of man that can't be explained on evolutionary grounds. Each woman's is unique, and Brunsengett thinks that they are randomly determined.
Huh, said Lance. Give me an example.
There are loads of examples in the book. I've forgotten most of them. No, wait, I remember. Brigitte Bardot was driven wild by men with pot bellies and spindly arms. And Garbo liked short, bald men with buck teeth. There are others.
Do you know, that would explain a lot, said Jane. It would explain nearly all my friend's husbands.
Well, I just hope it doesn't catch on, said Lance, getting up. I don't need competition from ugly guys, too. He looked at his watch. And I better make a move. Don't like to keep a lady waiting.
Jonathon stood up, followed by Jane, who said,
You really must come to lunch tomorrow, Jonathon.
Lance nodded.
Jonathon was surprised. I'm working tomorrow, he said, and quickly added, I think my lunch break's at 1, though.
Well, then, we shall meet at 10 past. Where do you work?
Harrods, part-time.
Goodness, which department?
Men's ready-to-wear.
Well then, I know a wonderful little place near the Natural History Museum.
About 1:10?
Yes. I'll see you then.
Then.
Shall I tell you the name of the place and where it is?
she smiled. Oh, yes, that might be useful. They arranged it, and Jonathon remained at the table for a couple of minutes after Lance and Jane had left, gathering up his laundry bag and washing powder. He decided to leave the leaflets, which by now had probably formed an indissoluble adhesive bond with the table. He felt slightly embarrassed to be left there alone, but he didn't want to leave too soon in case he bumped into Lance and Jane again outside and had to say goodbye all over again. He had managed it fairly well the first time, he thought. He didn't want to mess it up, not before he'd even had a chance to mess up meeting them a second time. Chapter 7.
Where to, mate?
Do you know the Wilmington Arms?
Just next to Acacia Road.
That's it.
Lance didn't know why he hadn't asked the taxi driver to take him to Sarah's door. Perhaps he would look back one day and say that this was the moment that his detective's instinct was born. Or perhaps his impulse to lie was just so strong that he couldn't even tell a taxi driver the truth about where he wanted to go.
They arrived.
He got out, cleverly avoiding a puddle, and paid the driver. It was 5:30, still Sunday, still just about light.
He looked wistfully at the pub, then rounded the corner onto Acacia Road. It lay in that vast, worryingly ugly area that seems to surround Finsbury Park in all directions, as though anti-style gas is leaking out from a vent beneath the station. It had rained while he'd been in the cafe, and the buildings, like the dogs, now looked either bedraggled or aggressive in their dampness. There was only a dribble of daylight left, not enough for him to see the house numbers, so he walked up the path of the first house he saw. The number turned out not to be a number, just a fancy brass knocker with Victory written on it. The next house did have a number on it, but as he was peering at it, he noticed that an old lady was peering at him through the window, holding a small, worried-looking dog in her arms. He waved cheerily at them and tried to signal that he was just looking at the number on the door. Finding that there is no signal capable of conveying that message, or at least that what signals there are look very like those for, "I'm coming in to kill you and take all that money you've got under the bed," Lance moved on. Finally, he found the right house, number 42. Pushing open the painted wooden gate, he made his way up the path, past a small wet garden, half overgrown and half newly dug, and up to the door. An ornamental wagon wheel leant against the front wall of the house, which disturbed and disappointed Lance. It seemed unlikely to him that someone who had an ornamental wagon wheel would also have anything interesting to tell him. He rang the bell and waited for a while. There was no answer and no sound from inside, though a light was on in the hall. He tried knocking, pointlessly, since his knock was much quieter than the bell. There was still no answer. He checked the number on the door, then rang the bell again. He looked at his watch. It wasn't much more like 30 minutes since he had talked to her. Had she popped out for milk? Fallen downstairs and knocked herself out? Been hideously murdered? He just didn't know. Perhaps she was waiting for him on the couch in a silken negligee. If so, he would tell her that he was already in a committed relationship, but probably not that the committed relationship was with his self-respect and every attractive woman he could find. He gently turned the handle, and even more gently tried pushing the door. It moved easily, soundlessly. He didn't open it properly, just a crack, just enough to know that it was unlocked. If he heard footsteps, he could close it again without anyone noticing that it had been opened. He waited. He did not hear footsteps. He glanced around quickly and casually, as though to see if it looked like raining again. He opened the door, stepped inside, and closed it after him. In a large number of films that he had seen, doing exactly what he had just done proves to be a very unwise move. Was there a little girl with red eyes, rotting green skin and razor-sharp teeth, standing perfectly still by the door? He checked. No, there wasn't. He retrospectively changed his motivation for checking. It pays to know where you are, he thought. Take in all available information.
Miss Morecambe,
he called. His voice was a little bit higher than usual, and there was something about calling Miss Morecambe in a slightly high, wavering voice that made him feel ridiculous. He felt, all at once, as if he were Terry Scott.
Sarah,
he tried, in a deeper voice. There was no answer. The house was completely silent. Take in all available information, he repeated to himself. He knew that there was no rotting, demonic, possessed little girl standing by the door, but he realized that he had not really absorbed anything beyond that. Besides, he shouldn't be thinking about horror films. He should be thinking about more realistic dangers, like teenagers with guns and poorly developed senses of right and wrong. Lance surveyed the hallway. Someone was moving in or out. By the stairs stood a stack of packing crates. In one corner lurked a colony of curtain poles. On his right sat a pile of blankets. Beside them huddled a family of battered suitcases. Nearby, a box of empty jam jars awaited. He imagined a long and fruitless storage under the stairs. All around were other domestic refugees in this camp for displaced decor, made harsh and pale by the naked light bulb that hung in the center of the ceiling, amplifying the angles of the artex. Lance moved slowly forward, his feet scrunching on the once deep pile of the carpet. As he drew parallel with the stairs, his foot caught on something. The handle of a paint roller skittered away, demolishing a neighboring pile of coat hangers. Lance winced as they clattered to the floor, and then jumped as he heard a sudden terrifying noise from upstairs. It came in a burst, then stopped. He waited, not breathing. Seconds passed. Then the noise sounded again. It seemed to be coming from one of the upstairs rooms. Lance prided himself on being one of the most self-possessed people who has ever lived. But that noise spooked him. When it sounded a third time, he broke out in a brief, localized sweat. The noise was like nothing he had ever heard before. If someone invented a small motorized device for destroying carpets at great speed, that was the noise it would make. Lance took stock of himself. He found he had adopted an absurd crouching position, and that he actually was holding his phone like a club. His head was sweating, and his pulse was racing. What had happened to him? He was supposed to be cool, for God's sake. He straightened himself up, mopped his face on his sleeve, and decided that the cool thing to do would be to just wander upstairs and see if anything interesting was going on around there. Maybe hang out and shoot the breeze if there happened to be an armed intruder about. This, of course, was also the stupid thing to do. But that was less important. He sashayed up the stairs, looking casually about him, trying to ignore the idea of a murderer shredding carpets in one of the bedrooms. The house was very nearly as vile as anything Lance could imagine. The carpet on the stairs was a sort of swirling orange, green and black nightmare that had been popular in the 70s. The wallpaper was such extreme flock that the pattern seemed to stand a good 2 inches off the wall, and the stalactites of the artex on the ceiling threatened at any moment to snap and impale him. Even under such extreme conditions, even with his heart pounding, his stomach pumping, and his head sweating, Lance still noticed all details of interior decoration. On the landing was a frieze, starting to become unglued, depicting a satyr cavorting with half a goddess. He was so distracted by it that when a dark mass came hurtling towards him from one of the rooms, he fell downstairs. Chapter 8. At almost precisely the same time that Lance was falling down Sarah's stairs, Andrew Thompson, an indiscreet delight, according to the Telegraph Society columnist, was descending the 4 stone steps leading away from the main lawn at Blythesides, his country estate in Oxfordshire.
Andrew, darling, it's the telephone, said his wife, Margaret,
meeting him on the path. I know, Gargi, darling. You have already shouted it twice across the lawn. People will think you're drunk. Will they be going soon? You know I can't stand the Brendans. What's wrong with whispering it quietly in my ear? Telephone, darling. Or telling a waiter, white gloves in a discreet murmur. The soft smile. Would you excuse me? I have a rather important call to attend to. Much better. I adore Tristan and Claudine, but why always the Brendans? No one reads the Telegraph anymore.
Is it the one in the drawing room or the study?
The study. I think it's going to rain this evening. The tablecloths will be ruined.
Oh, hang the tablecloths.
I love you, Andrew.
In his study, he closed the door, sat down on the Thomas Hope chair and took up the receiver.
Yes?
He stared intently at the dial.
It's done. Good. Thank you, Jenkins.
He leaned back in the chair, his favourite.
I shouldn't worry about that. Your services will not go unrewarded.
He replaced the receiver in its cradle and looked out of the window. It had been a beautiful afternoon, but now it was clouding over. The dark was falling, and his guests would be getting ready to go. The weekend was over. Tomorrow he would return to the Commons, return to the fray. Part of what he enjoyed about these weekends was imagining that he was glad to be away from London. In fact, nothing could be further from the truth. During the long recesses, he pined for the Commons. As a boy, he had once heard his father say to a friend, "Home's all right for a visit, but I wouldn't want to live there." Now he felt the same way. It was the way an Englishman of the best sort, the old sort, should feel. After all, hadn't the empire itself been simply one enormous excuse to pop out for a bit, get away from wives, children and mothers-in-law, stretch the old legs, kill people, and indulge in dangerous and exotic sexual practices? The only time he had resided permanently at Blythesides was that awful period 11 years ago. He had seemed to be finished, washed up, as the Americans say, washed up and left in the cold on the rack to slowly drip dry. Then the letter had come, the offer, and again the steady upward tick of his fortunes. He would not allow anything to interrupt that. Was he still, he sometimes wondered, bound by the terms of the agreement he had made? He came down to see them off, those last few who had not already left. They were hanging about on the blue carpet in the entrance hall, assembling coats, checking keys, waiting to say goodbye. The door was open, admitting cold, fading light into the hallway, softly illuminating the great oak beams and the stonework of the outside wall. These last few, like all today's guests, were largely people he disliked but hoped would be useful. Thompson reached the foot of the stairs.
"Goodbye, Andrew. Thanks for a wonderful party," said Peter Hampton, a Treasury Minister who looked like a sack full of ghosts. "Goodbye, Peter," said Thompson, shaking the man's baggy white hand.
"Goodbye, Margaret," said Peter.
"Yes, goodbye."
The next to shake his hand was Michael Apotolomito, who looked like a handsome man who had unexpectedly had a mixed grill attached to his face and who always said serviette instead of napkin. After him came Brian Brendan, who was something at the Telegraph, and then Tracy Bannister, deputy chairman of the party. Each of them had a spouse, to be kissed or backslapped, whose name Thompson could not quite remember. Finally, there were the only guests for whom he had any real affection, Tristan and Claudine Mangifuco.
"Bye, Tris," said Thompson.
"Splendid party, Andrew."
There were just the four of them now, standing on the front steps, watching the cars pull away. Tristan Mangifuco was short, with a flat, bald head, which would have made an ideal place to rest a drink, had he not been so obviously one of his party's great hopes for the future. Mangifuco pulled his wife's fur coat more snugly about her neck and stroked it down over her shoulders. Mangifuco was easily the calmest and least Italian person Thompson had ever met. His surname,
Italian for fire eater, didn't suit him at all.
In almost 15 years, Thompson had never known him to lose his temper. He was Italian only in looks, with his light olive skin, the sheen to his long black moustache and collar-length hair, and the fact that all his jackets, even the tweed thornproof he favoured for country wear, were double-breasted and shiny. Claudine, his wife, was taller, and her personality was as quintessentially French as Mangifuco's was not Italian. She had made Hampden bring her drinks all afternoon, rather than using the hired waiter, and she disdained entirely to speak to Michael Apotolomito.
"So lovely to see you again, Claudine. You're looking wonderful," Thompson told her.
"Yes, you are looking old, but still a little bit handsome."
Mangifuco, who out of habit was standing two steps higher up than her, took her hand and kissed it. "Come along, my love. Stop flirting with Andrew. Goodbye, Margaret. It was a fine party."
"You must come to us next, Andrew. I will see you in committee tomorrow."
"I am coming along,"
said Claudine, a little drunk.
"Till tomorrow, Tress. If Brendan does his part, then Apotolomito won't know what's hit him in committee. He'll be finished. And if all this will not do, we'll drown him in the Malmesbury butt within.
Shakespeare, Richard III. Mangifuco was constantly attributing Thompson's literary allusions. It was the one thing that irritated Thompson about his friend. However, there was a great deal to set against that single annoying habit. He knew everybody, was colossally rich in a way that put Thompson's inherited castle to shame, and everything always went exactly the way he wanted it to.
"Quite so," said Thompson.
"I do wish you wouldn't do that, though, Tris."
"Oh, you know me.
If I know something, I can't resist showing off about it. I was a modest man until I met you." His eyes slid to his brand new Rolls Royce, where it sparkled in the driveway.
They had been friends even before they went into politics. Thompson had been in the house longest, followed 5 years ago by Mangifuco, who had waited until he was indisputably and unassailably rich.
"Showing off is the fool's idea of glory," said Thompson.
"Is that a quotation?" asked Mangifuco. Uniquely in politics, their friendship had endured. They complemented each other. The extraordinarily wealthy businessman and the raffish semi-aristocrat, and their areas of interest did not conflict. In politics, everyone is alone, possibly because it's difficult to make friends when everyone around you is detestable. It is an immense advantage to know that there is one person in the house who will not betray you, even if they know that, for example, you are a serial adulterer with a truly gigantic collection of Hitler memorabilia. That was why Thompson and Mangifuco were the rising stars in the firmament of the commons. They had few secrets from each other.
"It is a quotation, yes. Bruce Lee, the noted martial artisan," said Thompson.
"There you have me. I know nothing about that world. About everything else, on the other hand, I know everything. As I said, I was a modest man until I met you."
Claudine tutted theatrically, flashed her eyes at Thompson, and said to her husband,
"He is really a bad influence on you."
Chapter 9. It took Lance a couple of minutes to work out where he was and what was happening. Then he remembered. He was lying at the bottom of a flight of stairs in someone else's house with a folding garden chair digging painfully into his shoulder. He looked up from his supine position and into the biggest, greenest pair of eyes he had ever seen. The cat and he remained frozen, watching each other warily, silently, for a good 2 or 3 minutes, until eventually the cat broke off eye contact to lick its bottom. It had clearly been the cause of the carpet-destroying noise upstairs. A wave of relief swept through Lance, closely followed by a wave of embarrassment. He hated anyone to see him when there was a folding garden chair digging into his shoulder. With some difficulty and reluctance, Lance arranged his body once more in a vertical position and began again the slow climb upstairs. He was shaken by his fall, and his initial relief was ebbing away. True, the terrifying noise had turned out to be only a cat, but there was no reason why there couldn't be both a cat and a homicidal sociopath in the house. The cat sat perfectly still until Lance got halfway up the stairs and then barreled away again at top speed into the bathroom. It almost seemed as though the cat was deliberately trying to unnerve him. The bathroom was the closest to the top of the stairs, so Lance decided to begin there. He stood against the wall and pushed at the door. It swung slowly inwards until its handle clunked quietly against the wall. This gave him a view of the whole of the darkened room, the sink, the toilet, the bath, and some flat-pack boxes containing a self-assembly shower unit. The cat sat beside the toilet, looking aggrieved that he had followed it. There was definitely no one in the bathroom. He summoned his nerve and peered into the bath. There was definitely no one in the bathroom. This seemed to him uncannily like the sort of thought someone would have shortly before being killed or demonically possessed by something lurking unseen in the bathroom. Ridiculously, he looked up to make sure that there was no one clinging to the ceiling, poised to drop, and then checked behind the door. This time, he was certain of it. There was definitely no one in the bathroom. Meanwhile, the cat had grown tired of his intrusion and padded off into the next room next door. When Lance entered this room, the cat looked at him with undisguised impatience. "You again," its eyes seemed to say as it trotted away. This was obviously the main bedroom. There was a large double bed in the middle of the room, a dressing table, a huge pile of discarded clothes, some packing cases, a rolled-up carpet and a wardrobe. Lance checked over his shoulder, then lowered himself slowly to the ground. There was nothing under the bed except shoes. He forced himself to move over to the wardrobe, slowly, quietly. He grasped the handle and flung it wide, leaping back at the same time. An Indian-style dress fell to the ground, the coat hanger hitting the floorboards with a clunk. The wardrobe patently contained only clothes. The next room contained packing cases, a pile of curtains and a rowing machine. A dismantled bed leant against one wall. There was nowhere to hide, but Lance checked. He even looked behind the headboard of the bed, where he found the cat again. It looked at him with frank incredulity, its eyes flashing, "Oh, for fuck's sake," before it dashed away. The final room was much smaller. Lance was getting a bit careless now. He walked straight in without checking behind the door. Then, suddenly realizing this, he whirled around and came face to face with the cat, which had climbed onto the top of a bookcase. "Will I never be free of this poltroon?" said its grave green eyes. There was no one under the empty desk or hiding in the pile of dust sheets in the corner. Sarah was obviously not in. He was being stupid. She had clearly just gone out and left the door unlocked, and Lance wanted to get out of the house before she returned and found him there. He stumped downstairs, feeling a bit embarrassed. The best thing to do would be to go now. He would just look in the kitchen and living room first. The living room was empty, but in the kitchen he found a large dead woman. It was Sarah Morecambe. Her hair was lying in the cat's bowl. His first reaction to the sight of a dead woman in a kitchen was relief that she hadn't heard him wandering around the house and falling downstairs. The relief was followed by guilt at feeling relief when a woman was dead. The guilt was followed by apprehension that he would be blamed for her death. Confused, he gave up on feeling and went back to being cool. Perhaps he should make sure she really was dead before he jumped to any rash conclusions. "Oh, yes," said a voice in his head. "Maybe she's just resting on the kitchen floor with a knife wound in her abdomen. Perhaps that's how she relaxes." He had to pull himself together. He couldn't stand around making sardonic comments to himself in his head while a woman lay possibly dead in her own kitchen. He crouched down, careful not to get blood on his shoes, and gingerly felt her neck. It occurred to him that he had no idea how to interpret the results of a neck feeling. Her neck felt quite dead, but how could he be sure? After a while, he decided that if a person not only owned a neck that felt like the one he was currently feeling, but also lay motionless in a pool of blood and bore an obvious and horrific wound, that person could not possibly be alive. Back on his feet, he decided to look around for exactly 3 more minutes before contacting the police. The kitchen was the most completely decorated room in the house. It had fitted pine cupboards and expensive-looking worktops. On the new cooker, a very black piece of fish continued to fry. Nearby, on one of the expensive-looking worktops, were a woven bag, 2 cold cups of tea, a small sherry, a post-it note, and a manila file stamped HM Government. Written on the post-it note in big, looped writing underneath the words to do were the following items. 1. Journalist. 2. Grouting. 3. Get rid of wagon wheel. 4. Cat food. Lance very nearly added 5. Get stabbed to death, but the tiny part of his mind which dealt with morality and ethics asked him not to. The brain is a very adaptive organ, and Lance's was no exception. It had long ago noticed the lack of moral judgments it was required to make and had begun to store information about suit fashions in that area. His moral centre had been moved to the much smaller part of the brain which normally deals with prunella scales. An image of her came to his mind as this part of his brain kicked in again, telling him to call the police before shutting down, exhausted. At that moment, the fish pan caught fire. Looking around, Lance saw a tea towel lying on the draining board. He quickly ran it under the tap, threw it over the pan, turned the gas off. There was a very loud hiss, as though an evil spirit were leaving the pan, and a great cloud of steam went up. Just as he was beginning to calm down again, the smoke alarm went off.
Nerp, 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 nerp.
Shit.
Nerp, 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 nerp.
The sound was painfully loud. Surely the neighbours would come round to protest and he'd be seen.
Nerp, 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 nerp.
He frantically grabbed the folding garden chair from the hall, wrestled it open and upright.
Nerp, 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 nerp.
Clambered on it and pulled the cover off the smoke alarm.
Nerp, 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 nerp.
Then feverishly ripped out the battery. The noise stopped instantly. Lance sat down. His ears were ringing. He felt now as though he was somehow implicated in the murder. He'd had a good snoop around, felt her neck, put out the pan fire. If he hadn't been there, the pan would have continued to burn and the house would have caught fire. Was there such a thing as inverse arson? He needed to get a hold of himself. His mind was all over the place, and he wasn't thinking clearly. Where was his cool now that he needed it? He ought to call the police right now, he thought. No.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.